Welcome to This Is Getting Old. I'm your host, Melissa B., PhD, and today we're going to be talking about how we actually get to a diagnosis of Alzheimer's. And it's not as easy as you think, and a lot of times I'll hear people say, you know, it took years to get to a diagnosis, and that's actually a good thing, because there are a lot of things that can look like Alzheimer's that actually aren't, and you know, you want to be sure that with this that you're getting an accurate diagnosis. So one of the first things you need to do is make an appointment with your healthcare provider tell them, you know, get your journal out. From the other podcast, we talked about how you look for patterns over time so that you can provide a pretty good history to them, because your role as a family and a caregiver, you can give insights into that person's daily ability to take care of themselves at home differently than the older adult may, or your older relative may. And that could do with, you know, not wanting to be found out that they have a memory problem. So there are lots of different things that could happen, but your history is as important as the person that you're trying to get help for. So one of the first things that they're going to do is talk through what's your past medical history. So what are any illnesses that you've had in the past, any injuries you may have had, any hospitalizations you've had. Also knowing your surgical history would be important. So that they're going to ask you, you know, what types of operations you've had. One big thing that they should do is what we call a medication reconciliation. And that is where, you know, you need to take all of this person's prescription medications, all of their over-the-counter medications, any herbal supplements, I mean, anything that they are taking, you need to just throw it all in a bag and take it to a provider and let them, you know, flesh out, like, what's this person actually taking? A lot of times people will take more of the medication than they're supposed to. They may take less, and somebody having memory issues may not be able to remember to take their medication like they're supposed to. So one issue is, how are they taking the medication? But the second issue is that medication necessary? Like, is there a diagnosis to support why they're taking it? Are there any drug-to-drug interactions that could be causing a problem? Is there a drug-to-supplement interaction? So those are all the different things that you can find out when you have everything that that person could possibly be taking, so that we can rule things out. It could be that, you know, they haven't taken their antidepressant for 30 days, and that means, you know, this really isn't a dementia. We need to treat that depression again. The next thing that they should do is they should run some lab work. So we need to know, you know, what does their hemoglobin and hematocrit look like? Maybe they have anemia. You know, what's their white blood cell count look like? Do they have, you know, an infection that's brewing somewhere? You know, or are we having some other issues with that? You know, B12 deficiencies. B12 is another form of anemia. You have iron deficiency anemia. But, you know, a B12 shot, sometimes being low in B12 makes you look like you're demented, because you're having memory, your brain isn't working like it should. And so they need to run a test for that. You know, what does their blood sugar look like? Are they diabetic? Are they taking their diabetic medications the way that they're supposed to? What if their blood sugar has been running? Because if your blood sugar has been 60 for a couple of weeks, you could look like you're demented, but you're really just hypoglycemic. You have low blood sugar. Getting a urinalysis is important, and a stool sample, having a record of when their last bowel movement was and what did that bowel movement look like. And while this may be kind of personal information, it is important to know, have they been having adequate bowel movements enough? Also looking at their body weight. Sometimes that's the first way, that's the first clue to me as a provider that we may be dealing with a memory issue, whether you bring it up to me or not. Because if somebody has unintentionally lost weight over the past 6 months, that could be an early symptom that they're not remembering to eat, or they're not remembering how to prepare their meals. And so they're beginning to lose weight. or maybe they're having a lot of anxiety and so they're up and walking around more than they used to, but they're not eating enough food to keep up the output of the calories from walking around. So the next thing would be doing a complete physical exam. And so your provider would be able to do that. And then you can share some of the things that you've been seeing, and you may need to wait to do this outside of the exam room, or you may want to prepare like a very succinct timeline, like a one pager, because they're not going to have time to read your whole journal. But you could put some highlights of the patterns that you've been watching and when you're seeing these things, so that they can put that into the bigger picture as we're trying to figure out what's going on with this person. Another thing they may do, and they should do, are two different types of screening tools. They may use one or the other. But again, these are screening tools. They're not diagnostic. So one is a mini mental state exam, and the other is the Montreal Cognitive Assessment, or what we call the MoCA. And so we'll talk about the MoCA first. The MoCA, if you remember, we talked about the different parts of the brain that are impacted by Alzheimer's. The MoCA is broken down into visual spatial screening questions, naming, memory, attention, language, abstraction, delayed recall, and orientation. So this one typically starts out where there's like circles on a page, and you have to do like match the one to the A, then the two to the B, three to the C. And it's in this pattern that you have to put all that together, alternating those two things. The second item in that category is to copy a cube. So if you think about what a cube looks like, you might want to start practicing drawing your cubes. And it's always fun to watch people do these because they always have a different approach. Do you draw two squares that kind of overlap and then put your side lines together? And some people can just draw it. So I'm always amazed at how people solve these questions I ask them. And then the third part of that is a clock drawing test. And we talked about that where you have, they would draw, on this one, they would draw a circle and they would put the numbers to the face of the clock, and then put the hands to whatever time the provider asks them to do. And usually it's 10 past two. And, but again, here you're looking at what's the contour of the circle, you know, how many numbers do they get in the circle? Are they in the right place? And are they able to get the hands on the clock in order to do that? And so that's kind of the visual spatial screening test. And the clock drawing test and the intersecting hexagons is the equivalent on the mini mental state exam. The second part of the MoCA is naming. And for this, I often need to know like where this person's from, because the three animals that are pictured are a lion, a rhinoceros, and a camel. And, you know, there are people in rural areas, like my grandmother's one of those. She may not know what a rhinoceros is or a camel. So knowing where the person comes from, you may need to use different animals. But again, this is why it's a screening test. It's not diagnostic. For memory, we would give you five words. So I'm going to give you five words, and I want you to repeat them after me. They are face, velvet, church, daisy, and red. And if you're like me, the first time those questions were asked, I was a student and I was just sitting there listening to them. And I was like, I don't even remember what they just said. So they do get two trials to recall the five items. And then after 5 minutes, we ask you what those are again. So if you're looking for a good memory test to start doing while you're young, start having people give you five random words that you have to remember, and then 5 minutes later, tell them what they are. The next category is attention. And so I would tell you five letters in order. So 21854, you would repeat those back to me. And then, you know, I'm gonna give you three numbers and I want you to repeat them back to me backwards. So 742, you would be expected to say 247. In that instance. And again, you have to be able to pay attention to what I've asked you. You have to be able to hold that information, you know, those data points in your head, and either give them back to me as I gave them to you or flip them around. The next one is a list of letters. And basically I'm read this long list of letters, and every time I say the letter A, you slap your leg or you clap your hands. The next one is being able to do math. This is always another challenging one for me. Start at 100 and subtract 7, and you just keep going. And they need to be able to do that 5 different times. So 100 to 93 to 86, 79, 72, 65. So being able to do that in your head, like my dad would be a whiz at this one, and I would probably have to sit there and count on my fingers. And then the next part is language. And so if I said to you, I only know that John is the one to help today, and they have to repeat that sentence, or another one would be like, the cat only hides under the couch when the dog is in the room. And basically they just have to repeat those two phrases. The next one can be fun. It's fluency, and what we're looking to do is I would say, I want you to write down, you're going to have 1 minute, and I want you to write down every word you can think of that starts with the letter F. And then I time you, and you write down every letter, every word that you can think of. And for most of us, we can probably think of enough F words, but you need to be able to think of at least 11. And so if your brain is normal, you should be able to crank out 11 words without a problem. But if you're struggling with finding nouns, and you're struggling with language, like we talked about in the previous two podcasts, this can be challenging for you. For abstraction, we're asking you for similarities. So how is a banana and an orange similar? They're both fruit. How is a bicycle and a train similar? They're both ways that you can get around. They're both modes of transportation. Any of those types of answers would be okay. And then what is similar about a watch and a ruler? And both of those actually measure things. One measures time, one measures distance. And then I would go back and say, what are those 5 words? So can you remember what those 5 words were? So they were face, velvet, church, red, and daisy. So how many of those did you get? And if you couldn't get them all, I could give you a cue. And then if you were able to get them with a cue, then you still only get points for recall. But it's good if you can get them with a cue. And then the last part is orientation to kind of time and place. So we ask you what's today's date, what month it is, what year it is, what season it is, what day of the week, and the name of the place that you're in. And the mini mental state exam starts with that. But all of there are only 5 sections in the mini mental state. And but basically starts off with the orientation questions and then the registration. So I give you 3 objects, apple, table, penny, and then you repeat those back. Then we do the attention and calculation issues or questions, and then ask you what the 3 words were again, and then do some different testing around language. But again, all of that is screening tests. Another part that's going to be important is that you do have some scan of your brain. Typically a CT is what we would do. And that's because right now your brain is a grape, and it's a nice plumpy juicy grape, or it should be, and all the messages can get back and forth without a problem when you have a great brain. But what happens with Alzheimer's disease is your brain begins to shrink and shrivel, and so it basically turns into a raisin. And if you can imagine those deep crevices, and this is over dramatized, but the messages can't make that leap. And so Alzheimer's disease is brain failure, and we need to think of it as such. And everyone has a different course. So what might take me 10, 15 years, and I don't really change that much over time, somebody else could be very rapidly going through Alzheimer's, particularly younger onset. They're a lot more aggressive, and they just don't, it's a shorter timeline between when you're diagnosed to when you have very advanced disease. So the CT will tell us if you have what's called brain atrophy, or has your brain shrunk in any way. And it would also give us some insights if you had had any little mini strokes. So do you have kind of a combination of a shrinking brain and some small, what are called infarcts or spots on your brain where you've had like damage from either mini strokes, that type of thing. So again, a lot of that can take, you know, you have to go in and get the lab test, you have to go through the screening. You know, I would probably recommend even getting, you know, if you have a geropsychiatrist in your town to be evaluated for that also, because it will also give you insights into where you are having problems so that as caregivers, you know, if I know your problem is ordering things, like maybe you, or problem solving, maybe you can't figure out what order to put your clothes on, but you know that you can, but I know that you can put your clothes on. So as a caregiver, I would put your clothes on the bed so that as you pick them up, you're putting them on in the right order. So that's where knowing kind of where someone's strengths are and where their challenging areas are can be helpful to you as a caregiver. And also can reduce frustration, because if they don't have good recall, or you know they have problems with registration, that means that their language has progressed to the point that you probably sound like Charlie Brown's teacher. Wah, 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 wah. And so you need to use more nonverbal behaviors when you're trying to communicate with that. So we will do another podcast later about how some different strategies that you can use for different challenges as with Alzheimer's and how to handle it as the disease progresses. So I'll see you next time.
Thank you for joining me today for This Is Getting Old. If you'd like to know more, you can subscribe to my YouTube channel. And if you have any questions or a related topic you'd like to hear from me about, just let me know. Thanks.